Good evening, everybody. I'm Maria Perbellini, the Dean of the School of Architecture and Design, the new Dean of the School of Architecture and Design since about 6 weeks, so I can still consider myself new. Welcome to our fall semester lecture series. I'm very happy to introduce our lecture and exhibition coordinator, Associate Professor Naomi Frangos. I think she put together this semester a really outstanding, exciting lecture series with really prestigious guests. And I'm personally supporting very much the lecture series because I think it's one of the moments where our culture is impacted by the discourse and the criticality of some of our guests, and what they bring here to us is really an element of discussion that is important for the vibrant community that I hope we are. Please, Naomi, would you like to come here? I'd like you to introduce our distinguished guest tonight, Mark West, that will present moments of his work, and I'm looking forward to hear from you. Thank you, Mark, for accepting our invitation, and I'm delighted you are here tonight. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to tonight's lecture. Oh, yes, the image. Sorry, that's like an interruption instead of helpful. I don't see it. It's on the screen. Do you want to try to pull it up, Mark? Okay. Take two. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to tonight's lecture. First, I'd like to express thanks to Dean Perbellini for her generosity and support for making this lecture series happen, for NYIT for offering us the use of this auditorium, to Jennifer Mitchell for her continual investment in organizing these events, to all of our colleagues, faculty, alumni, staff, students, and friends who have come here tonight to hear Mark West speak. It is 2016. We are living amidst rapid, if not accelerated, changes in our profession, environments, atmospheres, the way we learn, study, work, think about design and architecture, how we play creatively, and certainly how we build. Some consider we're entering the third industrial revolution. Emerging digital technologies, energy of force simulations, file-to-machine production, robotics, virtual reality, are all at the forefront of shaping our design industries. This is exciting. It offers certain freedoms and controls to the architect as a maker, but it also makes us responsible to think critically for those machines that we're telling what to do. So if technology has brought us here, is there still a place for our hands to think too? Our tonight's guest, Mark West, is a New York native, has been exploring, integrating drawing and making for over 35 years since graduating from Cooper Union. His outstanding achievements in cross-disciplinary research, teaching, and practice merge the fields of sculpture, design, and engineering through drawing and hands-on exploration. He is known for having a blackboard, a literal one, in his fabrication lab, where he can pick up the chalk and draw out one-to-one what he is testing, going back and forth with calculations from his physical results. His work builds on Gaudi's genius use of gravity and sustainable design, precast pieces, and Miguel Fisac's exploration of form and surface using flexible formwork. The idea that matter has not yet become until the weight has settled and taken its preferred place and new life is the beauty of nature at work. I was first introduced to Mark in 2006, 8 years after he became founding director of CAST, a lab at Center for Architectural Structures and Technology at the University of Manitoba, We invited him to the University of Montreal to offer a workshop for our graduate level studio, Detail and Integration. Watching him work and play was a key moment when I truly appreciated how valuable it is to have hands-on workshop instruction in design schools. You just can't see forces acting on matter through a piece of paper, but really understand them when you are mixing aggregates, pouring plastic mixtures, and unveiling them as solid materials, and after you've gotten a few bits and pieces on your clothes. As inventor of flexible formwork techniques for reinforced concrete construction, Mark West has made an outstanding contribution to our field with an international presence teaching and doing research, full-scale prototypes, interventions, and built projects in Bath, England, Copenhagen, Denmark, Winnipeg, Edmonton, and Ottawa in Canada, Kentucky, Maine, Vermont, New York in the US, and is now visiting professor at MIT and will be visiting professor in Aarhus, Denmark next year. He has consulted for many well-known firms in Korea, Chile, Puerto Rico, Canada, and the US, including design studies for Herzog and de Meuron in New York, and has also published extensively in academic journals and was keynote speaker of the second international conference on flexible formwork, and is also the author of his new book, The Fabric Formwork Book, out this month. So before I give it over to Mark, I leave you with this one quote by architect Raoul Bouchotin, which Mark West has mastered so well. Technique is thought as the hand making an object often knows how to do it, and it is constant dialogue with the mind and the mind's instruments of perception. The action of technique transfers thought into substance, into objects endowed with intention and specificity. Turning this around means using technique blindly, as it were, letting thought slowly derive from the hand, knowledgeably making or playing things. Please welcome Mark West.
Thank you, Naomi, for that very nice introduction. Now we have to get an image. What do you think? There. That's good. Well, Naomi asked me to put in a few images of the CAST lab, so even though I'm not, could we take these lights that are right on me? I don't know if we can do, I suppose I have to be lit, but maybe not so aggressively. Okay, no, bring it down. Is that okay for you? It's better for me. Naomi asked me to put in a few images of the CAST lab, which is my abandoned ship. Yeah, we painted the walls black so we could make the engineers draw something they didn't like doing until they started doing it. That's Ronnie Araya. I may mention him a few times in this talk. He's was my co-conspirator for many years at the CAST lab. We had a structural testing press and strong floor so we could do some of the structural research in-house. But I'll start the lecture here in Istanbul. For 6 months of the year, I live in Istanbul. And this is early 17th century Han, Ottoman commercial building, except for the stuff that's in the courtyard, which is an improvisational, the kind of improvisational constructions in Turkey that I admire so much. That's where we shop. Right. If you've been there, you know, at least we might bring a certain atmosphere of life back to your back to you, put it in the room here with us. This is a kind of a half-assed map of the Dolmish system. Dolmish means stuffed, and little minibuses that are, it's an informal private public transport system that runs all through Turkey. In Turkey, nothing moves in a straight line. Nothing. Human relations, negotiations, business, traffic, you name it. These are drawings that I did in 1993 or 94 or so, when I was in Turkey for the second time, my second trip. So these are graphite drawings. We'll go inside a little bit, have a look inside this drawing. That's wiring in the Grand Bazaar. Nothing moves in a straight line. This is a geological map from the Army Corps of Engineers done in the 1940s of the Mississippi River. So when you think of the Mississippi River, it seems like it has a fixed position. You can map where its boundaries are. But if you have a long enough time period to look at it, it's a thing which is not at all fixed. This is where I spend about 4 months of each year, on a little island off the coast of Maine, otherwise uninhabited, except for my small family. So the forest floor has been what I see mostly. If I'm not on the ocean, I'm looking at the forest floor. And this is a drawing I call the emblem of the forest floor. So we'll go into this briefly. Just enter the drawing. This is a drawing I did after I did my thesis at Cooper. I did my thesis three more times because I knew I hadn't done it right. And this is one of them. So I don't know, this is like the second one after I graduated or something. This is a like highly magnified detail. Each one of those squares is about an eighth of an inch square. And it's a drawing of a glass block cavity wall. And this maniac young man is drawing the mortar joints. I mean, it's painful for me to look at this drawing. That's 6H pencil, multiple passes with a 6H pencil. So obviously this is a little OCDC problem, you know? This is the grid that I'm interested in now. And this one is much easier to make because it forms itself and is actually far more sophisticated piece of geometry, we could say, than that. And also, like as I say, a kind of effortless beauty and complexity. This is even more beautiful because this is obviously this cracked mud, right? And here the water has left its own geometric mark of waves on top of the crack. So this is wet and dry at the same time, isn't it? There's the mud in the park across the street from where we used to live in Winnipeg, and there's a semi-wild river that runs through Winnipeg and it floods occasionally. So there's the mud from the spring flood. That's a tire track. So now you have the natural, quote unquote, natural mud. Car drives across it. And so now there's a kind of mechanical imprint of the rolling tire treads. And if you stare at that a little bit, like you're looking at clouds, just staring at some beautiful cumulus clouds, you can see animals walking. Just take a little time and stare. You know how it goes. So these are, I call these blackouts. These are blackouts that happen just by time. the erosion of time, leaving these enigmas. In this case, it's sort of the opposite of the mud, where the mud was amorphous, but a figure arrives out of the amorphousness of the mud. Here, there's a figure that is now becoming more amorphous and more, doubtful. It's not quite clear what it is anymore. So there's a way to do drawings that I discovered actually when I was in Kentucky as a young man, trying to escape my education at Cooper with the grid. So here's a photograph. First, reorient the photograph, that's helpful. Stare at it, and then start blacking things out. And inside the photographic reality is another reality found effortlessly, with great pleasure, actually, kind of pleasure of finding this thing hidden. If you do a photo collage and then black out the photo collage, you can work off of a kind of armature or chassis of the collage and build a more complex finding in the drawings. This is graphite, so it's just 6B on top of photographs cut out of history books, basically. This is quite a big drawing. And that's a tiny little detail from that drawing. So none of these things are designed. My sense of authorship is very tenuous. I'm not the author of these forms. I'm the finder of the forms. And it was such a I won't say spiritual because that gets ridiculous, but it was an emotional, really truly emotional release to not be responsible for the shaping of these forms on the one hand, and on the other hand, they were better drawings than I ever thought I would ever make in my life. So I just kept making these drawings, making them. And I still use the technique. So these are very recent drawings. Now I'm going to just show you briefly some very recent drawings, and I'm going to here's the constituent materials of the collage. So shrimp from a market in Istanbul, Roman sarcophagus, some little electric motors from Hong Kong. Right, I take the photographs. I don't know whether this is like my remote control or something. Make a collage, print the collage on paper, and then draw inside, but this time with color. So that's now a found drawing inside the photo collage. So you can pull out, you can start with the genetics of bio, mechanical, present, past, whatever you wish to make in your gumbo, you cook it up, and let's go inside this drawing to see what was found. I'll go quickly through these because we have a lot to get to tonight. Here's another drawing. It's a detail of another drawing. That's the drawing. These drawings are about this big, maybe a little over 2 feet by 2 feet, something like that. That's a different drawing drawn on top of the same collage. It's a Photoshop collage printed on paper. So you print as many as you want, and you can black them out or color them out however you want. And each one reveals a different set of possibilities. You see different kinds of animals in the same clouds. We'll go inside this one briefly. I'm just going to scroll through these for you. Now, this photograph I took this summer in a little airplane over Penobscot Bay, as the wind was just coming up in the afternoon. So it's a light wind, it's just coming up. Look down, and you see this pattern. The dark branching parts are places where the wind, the new wind coming up, is not touching the surface of the water. And so the water is a section cut through this three-dimensional swirling of the wind. And for whatever reason, the wind is bouncing or hasn't touched the surface of the water. So that's a black, glassy surface. And the rest of it is being rippled by the wind. So here's a fixed figure. Those figures are fixed. I mean, they move like the Mississippi River moves, but slowly, or like the minute hand. You can't see it moving. You look at them, they're fixed. But they're made of a moving thing. Here's a sailboat. The fuel is the wind, which is solar powered. So the fuel is the wind. The engine is the sails. The sails are fixed. So any of you know, if you're sailors, you know, at a certain angle to the wind, you fix the sails at a kind of optimum angle, hopefully, to the wind, and the boat is fixed. And the fixed thing moves. So the engine has no moving parts. The engine are the sails, and they move simply by proportion and shape, fixed. But the motion and power is awesome. Okay, that's introduction. Now we'll talk about concrete and formwork. This is concrete as we know it. I don't know if you like this stuff. I hate this shit. I hate it. I just hate it. I really do. That's concrete cast in a black polyethylene or polypropylene woven geotextile. Very, very, very inexpensive material. It's like a dollar a square meter. And more to the point compared to this are the walls of Kenzo Ueno, Japanese architect and builder and inventor in Tokyo. And these are also cast in a textile mold. There's Kenzo-san. Uno-san, you're saying, right? That's the formwork for one of his walls. There's almost nothing there. Look at it. There's like nothing there. That's the construction netting. That's not even a woven fabric. That's like construction netting to keep debris, you know, off a scaffold. It's only braced laterally. The steel holds up its own formwork. That's the thing being filled. You see the vibration. It's done by poking it. And you pull the fabric off and reuse the fabric. And then you can compare the amount of material you need for such a wall, for such a wall form on the left compared to the standard. And it's essentially the same height wall. That's why I put these two together. Hundreds of times less material. You could do it by weight, by volume. You could do it by price. And when you pour into a permeable fabric, you know, I should probably turn this on, shouldn't I? When you pour into a permeable fabric, one that's not waterproof, what happens is the first thing that happens is under pressure, the air bubbles pass right through the mold wall. And then some of the excess mixed water passes through the mold wall. And that improves the water-cement ratio. So here's work done. Let me turn it down. Here's the age of the concrete, and that's the strength of the concrete, compression strength of the concrete. The black line is a normal waterproof mold, and the green and the red are two different permeable fabric molds. These are cylinders, or normal, you know, test cylinders like this. So you can get a higher quality concrete surface, a more beautiful concrete surface. It's less permeable, and it's stronger, although it's a surface effect. So on anything large, you don't get the extra strength in the structural section, but you have a much better quality on the surface of the concrete. Is this thing better or worse as a... Better. Okay, somebody said better. Here's a normal, pretty lightweight column mold. And here's a 30-foot column done in a tarp, plastic tarp. It's done in one lift. It's a slow pour rate, but it's done in one lift. This commercially available Fast Tube is the name of the product. And you'll notice at the base, there's no connection at the base.
The detail is, there's no detail. It's just the fabric comes to the footer and that's it. That seems impossible, but it actually, I could explain. If you're curious, I'll tell you later how it works. It's really very simple. These are drawings I did for a project in Puerto Rico to try to convince the client to do these sculptural columns, and showing A and B, two different methods, and the kinds of forms that might be developed. Oh, that slide didn't show up. Well, we cast some columns. That's the formwork for 13 columns, each one a different height. So 13 uniquely dimensioned columns, and then a couple of spares. And they came with me as my checked luggage from Winnipeg to the island of Culebra in Puerto Rico and then back again. So the logistics, the amount of material you need in the molds is so small that the logistics of construction are radically changed. And then you can play around with it because it's flexible, right? So this is two different fabrics. This is a spandex, it's like swimsuit material. That's a PVC coated truck tarp. Cut holes and then you make these kind of aneurysm columns. There's that one, that's in a children's theater in Winnipeg. Those are under pressure. But you can also use a fabric mold where it's not pressurized, so if it's pressurized, it looks like a body, like this is pressurized. Thank God it's still pressurized, right? So it's kind of inflated skins, like every cell in your body is the same thing. It's a pressurized membrane by hydrostatic pressure. But this is not. So there's another skin here, which is, you know, so you can use the fabric in that way as well. And it could be more or less wrinkled. So these are plaster casts. These are some of the experiments that we did in the kind of language of sculptural or language of architecture that we might be able to apply using various techniques. There's some larger scale sort of proof of concept casts made. That's a close-up. You can see the staple heads. But this is really blown up, right? The finish is spectacular, immaculate finish on these things. There's no air bubbles because of the filtering action that I was describing earlier. You can also take, instead of having random wrinkles, you can organize them. You take the wrinkles, and in this case, it's a kind of spine and ribs. That's the detail at the spine. And all of that beautiful repetitive or it's like daisies in the field. They're all daisies, but each one's a little bit different. These are all self-forming. The only thing you need to do is give it the setup. In this case, it's a rebar with a piece of small nylon rope wrapped in a spiral. And then we control where the wrinkles go to the edge. That's so when we cast multiples, the wrinkles will line up and we get a nice, right, continuation across the joints. If you take a fabric and you compress it, let's say, along one axis of the plane, it'll make parallel wrinkles. And if you compress it along both X and Y, it will spontaneously form branching shapes. It just does that. You can take those branching shapes and guide them through what we call a stencil frame. So you can provide a stencil frame. So you take the naturally branching shape of the flat sheet. By the way, everything I'm going to show you in the formwork, all these formworks, are all flat sheets right off the roll, no tailoring. That was a constraint, it was a kind of builder's constraint of simple construction that I've held my work to, like continuously through all of this stuff. So everything you'll see is just flat sheets. So in this case, we make a branching column model, scale it up. We could work at 1 to 10, and then go from 1 to 10 to 1 to 1 directly. If the model worked, we knew for sure the full scale would work. And it happened every time, even when we thought that this couldn't possibly work at full scale. It always did, without fail. So here's a heavier industrial fabric. It's just a geotextile, same polyethylene or polypropylene geotextile filled with concrete. So it's basically squeezed between, there's two of these, right? There's two pieces of plywood, they match, and you put them together and you get that column. Now, I can't show you everything. There's so much to show, and I had to get rid of a lot of stuff. But the two sides, the two stencils, don't have to be identical, and they don't have to match up. You do one stencil on one side, another stencil on the other side, and cast that. And you get two different figures that are joined where they overlap, if you see what I'm saying. So, you know, having developed these methods in models, tested them in full-scale prototypes. Then I've also occasionally drawn architectural fantasies using them, just to try to imagine what difference it might make in a space to be building in this way as opposed to with rigid prismatic geometry. So this is from a project called Hotel Edward Hopper, where I photographed those strange puppet people of Edward Hopper, if you know the American painter Edward Hopper, his really weird, kind of creepy puppet people in his paintings. And I thought it'd be interesting to, I don't know why, like interesting to build a space around them. So I projected the paintings, copied the people, and then started drawing the hotel. This is the courtyard of the hotel. I guess that's the lobby. There's the courtyard. And then another facade of the hotel here, which is basically the same formwork, that branching column, where the formwork stays on. And the formwork acts as a wall, and the cast concrete acts as structure. That is just an idea. It's kind of tested out in a possible facade. You can also use the branching horizontally, exactly the same thing, but horizontally branching. And you can also use the same branching of the fabric to make precast concrete trusses. Oh man. There's the trusses. There's a full-scale version. So you have these, what we call impactos, which are the plywood pieces, little cutouts like that, that will form the voids in the mold. And then you just stretch the fabric across it to make the mold. That's a 5-meter truss that we then broke. And that's the flat sheet. So there's two of these flat sheets on either side that make the molds. You can also take that flat sheet and stretch it tight like a drum head so there's no wrinkles. And in this case, there's a steel frame that allows us to pre-stress the fabric, pre-tension the fabric. And then you make some pattern underneath it, put the fabric down over the pattern of impactos below, fill it with concrete, and that's the, on the left is the panel cast from that rig. On the right is the panel cast from the panel on the left. That's the finish. And these are models, round 1 to 10. I mean, there's no particular scale in this case. Using exactly the same piece of fabric with different patterns underneath. Right? It's like a printing press. So you change it out underneath, put the thing back down, you have a different geometry. And these are some drawings. I don't know what this is. It's just, I do know what it is. I just, no time to discuss it at the moment. And then just playing with the fabric itself, you can query the fabric as to what kind of shapes it might like to have, instead of torturing it as we've been doing into, I guess the branching thing is in a way a kind of querying of it. Here's another one. You know this shape? It's the shape of a hanging curtain, a kind of swag of a curtain. Well, that's a flat rectangle hanging. That's the shape. That's funny, like I've seen this shape, and until I drew it, I didn't know what the shape was. But you can see it has this deep zigzag thing, and then it has the curvature going in the other direction. So this is a real shell. It has a deep double curved structure. That's it. And if you spray concrete, fiber reinforced concrete on it, you get a thin shell panel. Well, that's about an inch thick. Here's another rig. In this case, I'm showing, because this one doesn't explain how the edges are controlled, how the geometry of the boundary edges are controlled. But here's another quick example of how the boundary edges could be controlled so that each of the panels would mate up with each other, right? And just in case you don't believe me, that's crazy. We did that with plaster models, and it worked with the plaster models, but it seemed like impossible that it could work at full scale. But they were so beautiful that it was one of those things we just kind of had to do, and spent the money and did it. We're back in the hotel, Edward Hopper. Some little waiting room. I don't know where this is. So, makes you think, makes you wonder what kind of facade language might be possible once you know how to rigidify the fabric. So, standard scaffolding and then a drawing envisioning a kind. And this drawing was done really a long time ago before I knew how to do it, like how to lithically rigidify a piece of scaffolding fabric. I had no idea technically how to do it, but these really beautiful facades, I don't know if you think so, I find them absolutely beautiful, far more beautiful usually than the facade that gets unveiled behind them. So that was the project, just a wish fulfillment to try to imagine an architecture like that. But now we have techniques that get us close to such a building. And then you can, from the plaster models, you can start to imagine the spaces that would be possible with such shell structures, between such shell structures. So here's another shell panel in plaster. It's about that big. It's a pretty big plaster piece. That's Photoshop. And let's just look at that bit of forming right there. So there's in the mold, there was a string, a little cord that was pulled against the deflecting skin. So you can see the line made by that string, and then the shape of this meandering Mississippi-like meandering thing, there is an infinite number of solution sets for the geometry of those kinds of buckles. If you did it again, you would get a different distribution of the two-dimensional surface. Infinite number of solutions, all within, obviously, within a certain range. In this case, there's not an infinite number of solutions. We can call this, just so we technically understand each other, this is a push buckle, and this is a pull buckle. And the push buckles have an infinite set of solutions geometrically. This one goes from pull point to pull point. And you can do certain things, you can reverse them and you can get them to go in two lines or three lines or one line or whatever, but you know where they're gonna go. And here, the fabric is buckling at 90 degrees to its primary lines of tension. So that's Poisson's ratio, for those of you with the structures background. I think it is. There may be some mechanical things happening in the warp and weft as well, but you know, for every fundamental force, there's the opposite force that's developed at 90 degrees to it, the secondary forces. So it seems like that's what's happening along the tension line like this, and you get the buckling. And there's a plaster cast from a similar mold. And once you reverse the tension membrane into a compression shell, you take the buckling weakness of the fabric and you turn it into deep corrugations that have a buckling resistance in compression. At least I think that's what's going on. It has every appearance of this reversal of buckling weakness to buckling resistance and compression. But I've never found an engineer who will commit to it, because actually no one understands buckling, really. It's one of those things that engineers deal with but don't fundamentally understand. So here's some pull buckles. Well, they don't understand well enough to take that more fundamental question on. So here's some pull buckles, and you can use the pull buckles in making various shell shapes. So we're going to pull on this fabric like that, and now there's a rigid spine down the middle that the fabric is draped over, but the rest of this fabric is free. It's deflecting from one end to the other, so it's a funicular mold. Pure funicular tension structure, except for the straight spine down the middle. There it is, loaded with about an inch of glass fiber reinforced concrete. And then we flip it over, and the other side of the fabric is plastic coated. And here's the shape. This is the design shape. I call this a flayed beam. There's a straight line of tension. Okay, look, the thing about a beam is not very efficient. The most efficient way to resist a force is pure linear tension. Second most efficient, pure compression in a shell, funicular shell. A beam is not very efficient, material efficient, but it has a great bonus because there's no thrust on the supports. The beam holds its own thrust inside itself. So you can just put it down on top of two walls and you don't have to worry about buttressing them or tension ties or any of that stuff. They're fantastic that way. So the idea here is to have a compression shell that acts like a beam, that holds its own thrust. So there's the tension to take the thrust. There's the compression, which is a funicular shell. You understand what I'm saying when I say funicular shell? It's like Gaudi's hanging chains reversing into compression. That's the two-dimensional version of a funicular shell. You hang a thing like this. You get that geometry and invert it. It's pure compression for its self-weight. There's the mold, and we see the muscles running along the principal lines of tension stress that give us these nice deep corrugations for a buckling resistance in the thin shell. And the beauty of the flat sheet is that when it comes time to reinforce it, we can take a flat textile reinforcing mesh, and it will take exactly the same shape as the flat sheet shape. It's a flat sheet, flat sheet. Same will go if you want to roof it, put a roofing membrane down. The building materials around the world, some of them come in rolls, and they're flat sheets. So if you keep it all in that geometric constraint, it simplifies reinforcing and waterproofing and so forth down the line from a constructional point of view. So there's this thin shell being built up. Pull it out of the mold. So that's one being pulled off the mold, and that's Photoshop again. You can feel the forces, you know, even if you're not trained up to do structural analysis or anything, you don't have structural theory, these things are palpably, almost like palpably stressed, and is a kind of empathy. The sculptural empathy of the action, the original structural action, is still there. Won't go into this, but check out this beam. That's foam rubber and cardboard. The rectangular beam, can you see the deformation of that circle? That's what they call shear. It's really diagonal tension that develops in a beam, if you remember your beam diagrams and the whole problem of shear at the supports. And if you see this shaped beam, where there's actually less material in the beam, but it's shaped properly for the bending moment, there's no deformation in the web portion of the beam at all. There's no diagonal tension in the web portion of the beam. This is really, this is the way to shape a beam more efficiently. And you can do these kinds of shapes for beams with flat sheets of fabric. This is one way to do it. Another way is to take two parallel tables and just ruche in more fabric where you want a deep section and pull the fabric apart where you want a shallow section. Here's $5 worth of material that is in this lower beam mold here. So that's a 5 meter beam. Was that about 16 feet or so? There it is. And so this is a notional. These are not designed structurally, but they're made according to fundamental structural principles. So this is like a proof of the ease of forming a more efficient beam. And it asks the question of the structural engineers, how should it really be shaped? But fundamentally, it's the right path. So notionally, that's the amount of concrete you would save if you cast a beam like this, and this is a beam shaped for a uniform load. It works out to about 30% of the volume of the ordinary prismatic beam. Again, this is like the Shroud of Turin. I mean, this is the skin that comes off the curved beam. How you hold the fabric affects the ornamentation of the surface. So here the fabric is held at points, and you cast a beam in that, and you get these beautiful undulations between the kind of hot restraint and soft restraint of the mold rig. So the mold rig sets up a set of actions, a dynamic physical actions that translate directly into form. This is a drawing in the pink. It's not very pink in this projection, but the pink line there is the bending moment graph for a double cantilever, uniformly loaded double cantilevered beam. So here the basic structural strategy is we flip that down, and the depth of the beam now mirrors the bending moment curve that it wants. So we're only going to put material along the principal lines of where the force wants to flow through the beam. And then the plan here is showing that we're going to feed compression material in the compression zones, and we'll starve the concrete in the tension zone and just have enough to cover the steel. That's the strategy. That's the plaster model. That's the mold for the plaster model. It's a rectangle of fabric, one rectangle. That's the full-scale mold. That's about, I don't know, $50 worth of material. That's the mold. That's the beam. So that's, I don't know, a little over 30% saved. But the devil's in the details. And the forces don't go where you draw vectors. You could draw all the vectors you like, but when the force finally goes in the material, it finds its own way. And no one knows how these beams behave. These are like novel, kind of novel beams. So there's a bunch of engineering research now that's gone into it, and it turns out the shape you want is like those shapes, but when you get to the supports, you want to splay out and get enough material in there for the vertical shear, and also for the what they call, you know, what you would put stirrups in if you've done any concrete design. So these are various beam shapes that have been investigated. You can also, these are just quickly some other ways of shaping a beam. In this case, we're pre-casting a T-beam, and we can make a stencil frame in the two tables and stretch the fabric along a keel at the bottom. So now we can decide what we want for the longitudinal geometry of the beam. And we can stretch it into the stencil frame, put the two halves together, and cast this ribbed T-beam. There's the model, and that's, again, Photoshop of what the ceiling would look like. These beams have not been tested, structurally tested. This is a drawing that I received from Byung-Soo Cho Architects in Korea. And I'm going to build this corporate welcome center guest house thing for a very large Asian construction company. And so they drew this three-dimensional drawing of these undulating, deeply undulating walls concave, convex curves. How can they cast them in concrete? They want to do tilt-up walls. And so they sent it to me, and they said, you know, could this be done in fabric? And we'd done concave cast, we'd done convex cast, but I hadn't done one that was both in the same shot. So I said, okay, that's interesting. So I said, we'll be your research lab. And this is a plaster model. Here's some of the, what we did, we just sent them things like this, sent them like JPEGs with arrows and notes. I said, do this, do this, do this. And they did it. And this is it's the Haniel guest house, I guess they call it. And then there's this project for a canopy outside a new women's hospital in Winnipeg, Manitoba. We worked on this for years, and it didn't get built. Or at the very end, it didn't get built. So this is a heartbreak one. The design, there's four, if I remember correctly. This is two units together, and let's say two modules together, and there'd be four modules total running down the sidewalk. There's only two molds in the whole thing, one for the column, one for the slab. We wanted to do shells. The precaster said he couldn't give a price for a shell. I said, what could you give a price for? He said, flat slab. Okay, so we'll do a flat slab, right? That's the flat slab with beam drops. And that's the detail. There's a really nice detail of how the column meets the slab. It's kind of like the slab just flows like water without touching the column tops. That's the model Ronnie made to solve the problem. It's a brilliant model. I just think this is like a pure genius model. It's a piece of trace paper. Five capital points of support on the flat plate slab, and he just pushed the tracing paper down and started drawing radiating beams. There's the five capital points. There's a piece of fabric stretched across it, and now it's a more elaborated drawing. So you have to imagine it, right? You got all this extra fabric. As soon as you push up, you got all this extra fabric. You kind of pull it out this way, pull it this way, and the pins are holding it into a shape. It's you sculpting or drawing with the excess fabric. Then this is sprayed with plaster, modeling glass fiber reinforcement shell, thin shell, like a half inch of GFRC. But we spray plaster on this, rigidify it, turn it over to make the release surface for the mold. That's a plastic-coated fabric. Put the edges around it, and then cast the model. It's a 1-to-10 model. That's a 9-meter unit at full scale. Scale it up. There's the model. I mean, you could do this. To me, it's still kind of amazing. We work at 1-to-10. And then go to 1-to-1. And that was it. So we could just like figure out how to do it in the model, and we just do it again, but we just do it big. So we cast these as the support points, the bumps for the support points. Stretched heavy fabric across it. The fabric was only 10 feet wide, so we had to invent a joint, which I don't know if we'll see that one. So here's the model. Instead of a push pin, that's a round piece of 3/4-inch plywood made with a hole saw and a screw. And then to get the screws out, because you got to get the mold up and turn it over, so to get the screws out, we put PVC pipes over the round pin heads, you could say. Right? That's it. GFRC, rigidify it, flip it up. There's a plastic-coated release surface. And there's the joint. The joint makes a really beautiful drip edge, actually. That's the 1-to-1 test cast. And the columns, that's the model of the column. We want these columns to rotate down down the street rotating like this. One to give lateral restraint in all directions, right? And the other one was so that it wouldn't be, you know, this precast is so horrible, isn't it? You know, bomb, 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 bomb. It's kind of horrible. So the idea was that they would always somehow appear different. There's a round side and a tapered flat side on these columns. That's the model mold. Ronnie worked on this. That's the fabric skin after a cast. You'll notice this one is sort of tailored. We took a cut. We had to make a cut. But that's OK. You can cut. You just need a knife. You cut it. So it doesn't go against the tailoring rule because it's dead simple, still dead simple. That fits in there. You cast. Scale it up. And then we did a water test. Because there's no software model that will tell us the exact shape and dimension, especially at the kind of crotch of this thing, which gets very complex. And the fabric does its own calculations, and we don't know what that shape is. And that's, of course, where the column is meeting its weld plates at the base. So that's all has to be known. So in this case, we needed the full-scale mold before we could actually figure out the true deflection of it. The water's still a little bit different from the concrete, but it gives a very close approximation. So we're able to do one-to-one drawings of the sections. And now we can do a set of CAD drawings to send off to the engineer and the architect. And the steel gets designed and so forth. All right. Now, all of this and more is in the Fabric Formwork book. Which is a how-to book. There's three other chapters that are not how-to chapters, but the bulk of the book is how-to. So there's stuff on textile structure, explaining how woven structure works geometrically and so forth, details for how you make attachments, tools and techniques and materials for that, form ties and walls, and there's the joint. That's the joint of the fabric, the mold I just showed you, and that's done with cable ties, zip ties, edge details for wrinkles. You know, how to get a wrinkled thing, how do you make an edge detail? We have a very beautiful set of simple solutions for that. And then primitive methods of pre-stressing. It's very important to me that all of the methods, well, nearly all of the methods that we would develop could be used anywhere in the world by anybody. And you wouldn't have to do it in Zurich, you know, right? So they're very, very simple methods. I mean, you can get tremendous power out of some very simple rope tricks. Foundations, other work done around the world. This is some precast units done in Chile. The Open City Group of Architects. There's a chapter on the history of fabric formwork, much of which I had no idea about till Diedrich Wienendahl, a brilliant young engineer, Dutch engineer who's getting his PhD at the ETH in Zurich at the moment. So here's floor systems developed by Gustav Lilienthal. And he made a good living off of this stuff. And there's lots of these buildings. Some of them have historical status in Germany, and this was used in the United States as well, actually. I've seen a couple of these old buildings using his system. James Waller, a very interesting character, is an Irish engineer who developed this beautiful system of making thin shell vaulted structures where you just have these parabolic arches, you stretch a burlap, was using burlap at the time, and then you render it with a thin layer of mortar. There's no tension in this structure. It's all compression. The whole thing is compression, and it has a double curvature for buckling resistance. He made a good living of this. He built, I don't know how many millions of square feet got built around the world using this method. There's Miguel Fisac that Naomi made reference to, who used plastic sheets stretched horizontally, much like those horizontal cast panels. He used them for precast panels in a whole series of architectural projects. It's also been used, it is still used in India to make small span compression vault structures in precast units that can be lifted by hand and put up to make lightweight roof structures, very strong lightweight roof structures that can be then covered with earth for thermal mass. And here's George Nez with his fabric hypar roofs. So it's stretched fabric across a frame to make these hyperbolic paraboloid shapes, and it's rendered with Portland cement and latex mix. It's been used since the 60s in the field of geotextiles and underwater construction. So here's a Norfolk Marine using a sheet of permeable fabric. They're about to drop that down underwater and cast concrete against a bulkhead underwater. And these are products sold for underwater pipelines, foundations for underwater pipelines. So these are pumped full of grout and essentially inflated like a waterbed or something underwater. Now, here's a recent experiment that I did in a workshop with Remo Podreski at the University of Edinburgh. And Remo's been doing fabric form work. He's an engineer, very interesting engineer. And he wrote the first book in English on Eladio Dieste, if you know Dieste's work. So here we are. We make these bags, fill them with a grout, stack the bags, and then they harden, you take them off, take the fabric off, and then put them back together again. So they mate perfectly minus two layers of fabric, right? One for this one for the one above. So that's just enough for either epoxy or a thin mortar joint. So these, think of them as masonry units. They're attached back together again, they mate perfectly, and they lock. There's only one way they can go together. You can move them around they lock right in. Now, that's a kind of a sad pile, really. You know, I don't know, it's a kind of like Eeyore, reminds me of Eeyore. It's like, it's a sad thing. But it's a very interesting thing happens if when you put them back together again, you put them the other way. Wait, like, they're kind of happy. They seem, no? Isn't that odd? Like, what's that about? It's innate. It somehow is innate. It's like you reverse the gravity and it's like, feels good. Like, and that's something that the precast with this, because it's heavy, you know, and the deflection. But if you're doing a precast thing, then you can invert it or you can turn it sideways. So the wind of gravity could blow in any direction you want. Details. Okay, now I'm going to shift gears. What time is it now? How are we doing? Anybody? 7:30, that's 1 hour. You still with me? Okay, well, you leave if you don't want to, obviously. But now I'm going to shift gears. This is like a little parenthesis to start another line of thought. This is a computer drawing according to engineering calculations of the shape of a horizontal open trough fabric filled with concrete. That's the shape it will take by fluid pressure. Any fluid pressure trough cast horizontally will give you a shape, let's say, like this. If you want to transfer that, so we wanted to know that because we wanted to be able to build a bulkhead to block off the end of a mold, which is a horizontal trough. So we got our friends in Bath to do the engineering work, do the calculations, print it out, say, okay, now we have to scale it up and draw it on a piece of plywood and cut the plywood. So I said, oh, we'll use a spline. We just run a spline. We get the points, made a grid, you know, found the points on the grid, and then put the spline. And a weird thing happened. I only needed 3 points for the spline. The spline curve is exactly the same curve as the pressure curve. So, I mean, what does a uniform stiffness thing in bending have to do with pressure that goes from zero to maximum? And like what? But it does. This is one of these deep, deep laws of nature that was thrilling to find. So with a simple spline, you can draw pressure curves. It's very useful for the rigid parts of the construction. So here's a different series of they're called elastica curves. That's the geometric class of curve is called an elastica. So here's Lancelot Kaur, who worked alongside, he was doing his own work at CAS, but you know, alongside, we spent a lot of time together working in the lab. He was working on his own stuff. And he was making these ice, and it gets really cold in Winnipeg, and there's a winter festival, so he's making these ice structures for the skaters, big long skating thing on the river in Winnipeg. So he wants to make these shells where he sprays water on fabric, much like Heinz Eisler did, if you know Heinz Eisler, the great shell engineer, German shell engineer. He had an ice garden himself. So Lancelot was interested in doing that as well in Winnipeg. And he was like bending rebar, and rebar is heavy, and it doesn't really bend, you know, it goes plastic. But we'd been using these fiberglass splines. So I said, Lancelot, let's get some fiberglass, you know. So he got a bunch of fiberglass splines and made these amazing things. It's like cable clamps or pipe, you know, pipe clamps. And these are fiberglass rebars that you buy instead of steel, you make fiberglass rebars. So he's got these right from the rebar manufacturer. And when he was doing that, I said, oh God, that's a pretty amazing stuff. So I thought about masonry, because John Oxendorf at MIT, who wrote the book on the Guastavino company, I don't know if you know about it, the Guastavino shells, he did two shells at the Venice Biennale recently, the current Biennale. So I've been thinking a lot about, you know, I'm a big Gaudi fan, so these thin shell masonry vaults, and John's like the world's expert, he's a friend of mine, so it's like, okay, like, should do something. I taught a class with him last year at MIT. And this was a proposal that had happened the year previously, that instead of building to a mason's line, you could build to a mason's spline. So the mason, all the mason needs, if you think about masonry is 3D printing. It's construction by deposition, like that. It's 3D printing. But the sensitive print head is the mason's hand. How do you give geometric instructions to the print head? That's the problem. If all you can do is give it a straight line, then you're stuck with developed surfaces. You're limited to developed surfaces, like Eladio Dieste's work. I don't know if you don't know these people, I should probably have a whole little list of names that you could look up. Maybe it's an oversight in this lecture, but so there's the idea that you have a mason spline. And Sean Bailey, who was an MArch thesis student of mine in my last year in Winnipeg, he took this on and started making models using these little splines and mason's lines and mason's splines to try to develop some these old little models, work on that. Okay, so he worked on that. And then left Manitoba, go to MIT, and gave the same question to some of the students there. And this guy, Nick Kroll, who's, where's he from? I think he's also from Holland. And he's developed these launchers. It turns out if you hold the spline, spline's making an elastica curve, which is not like, it's not a funicular curve, or at least not for, it's a funicular for some kind of loading, but not for like a uniform load or something, right? So it's like not exactly the right structural curve. But if you constrain the spline at the beginning at the ground, you can get it so that it's within a certain construction tolerance, very, very close to a parabola. So that's one little trick that he figured out. And then the other way is to simply give points in space and then run the spline across those points in space. So you force it into the curves that you want, but you get a guide. These thin shell masonry techniques of the Catlin vault, you don't need to support the bricks as you're building. The bricks support themselves. You just need a geometric guide so the mason knows where to put the bricks. And you need the proper geometry because it's a thin shell. So here's Jonathan Desi-Olive and Nick Kroll building a vault in this little workshop class that we did. And then the next year, which is this year, those two students went with John Oxendorf to Venice to do the Foster and Partners, this drone port project. And there's the splines. So now we have a new method of guiding the mason's hand, in this case for a thin shell vault. But you could use it in other ways as well. Just a little details of how that all worked. And briefly, here's Sylvia Siaminska, another MArch student in the same class in Winnipeg, who was interested in masonry as well. But she wanted to mix the masonry and the flat sheets. So she started gluing MDF units, masonry units, to flat sheets and seeing what kind of geometries they made. So here's the hanging curtain, but now it's tessellated and rigidified simply by mortaring the joints between the units. The model gets scaled up. And mortar. And it's a half inch thick. These are like the fake brick. You know, you make a fake brick fireplace? You buy the bricks like a half inch thick. That's what she used. So that's pretty interesting. She built a great big mold using styrofoam bricks and spray foam as the mortar. We flipped it over, made a mold. And the nice thing about this mold is the mason knows exactly where to put each brick. So put a brick there, 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 like that. So now you don't need a mason to do this. You get the tile guy to do it. And then afterwards, you mortar. Oh, that's not good. I'm going to have to find this for you. Okay. Let's go back. Come on. Oh, crap. I really want to... I don't know why that didn't show up. Maybe I should try it anyway. No, crap. I really want to show this to you. What's the name of it? This is really awkward. Okay. Okay, it's not very big, but it'll do. So here's a flat sheet of fabric, units on it, and there's a support rigid frame, flat horizontal rigid frame. And so it buckles. Flatten it down, and look at all these buckles again. Now I don't know if there's an infinite number of solutions, but there are multiple geometric solutions to how the flat sheet would take it. And here, I'm just trying to get it symmetrical, and it's resisting symmetry. It gets close, and then it doesn't. But what the weird thing about this was that, I mean, it's alive. Look at that, it goes up. The weight of the bricks makes it go up. What's that? And the thing is, it's like a living structural organism. And I don't know what will happen with this, but it seems like a very, very interesting prospect for masonry construction. Very efficient masonry construction, actually. That vault that you saw from the Venice Biennale, like a previous built project in South Africa, maybe, that John Oxendorf did, uses compressed earth instead of fired bricks, just compressed earth units. And the reason is because once you have a well-shaped shell, the stresses are extremely low in a shell. So you don't need a very strong material, a super low embodied energy, really sustainable construction, almost no material in a thing, but you have to be able to find the right shape and guide the mason's hand. So this is like waiting to be developed, this kind of work. And Yeah. That's, I think, you know, we should probably leave it at that. It's. I would like to have enough time to have a conversation with you if you have any questions. So, I don't know, maybe we leave this one up just to do something. Okay. So that's it. That's what I have for you. And now, maybe there's questions. I hope there's some questions. I'll give you some time. I won't rush you. Yes.
Yeah, when you were talking about
Do you need a microphone?
Yes.
Okay, hold on.
Yeah, I was asking when you were talking about achieving an unpressured look, like when you compared your jacket to your the hand of your skin. How do you, is that when you were pouring the concrete underneath it, or are you still pouring it on top to create like a first mold?
Okay, good. Starts with a technical question. That's good. Okay, so if you make a vessel to contain the concrete, then the skin must be, it gets pressurized. But if you take the membrane and you coat it with really a sticky mix, and it's either being supported by something else underneath, like it's just lying on the ground and is wrinkled, or it's hanging in some way, or you're draping it over something, then it's not pressurized. It's in gravity. So the thing goes into gravity rather than pressure. And those are two different, I mean, it's still force, but it's a different distribution of the force. It's a different kind of force, like a different species of force. Right? Now, the thing about like the cells all inflated and your body's inflated, and when you dry out a celery stalk, it doesn't look like celery anymore because you take the water out of the cells and it deflates. Okay, the inflated, pressurized ones is like life. Life is like that. It's a coincidence, a mechanical coincidence of the inflated skin. And then there's this, the non-pressurized forms. And I mean, consider this. You're born from your mother's body. You arrive naked. And what's the first thing they do to you? They wrap a piece of textile around you, like textile. So you're not out for very long before your body is touching a textile. And if I asked, you know, each and every one of you, when was the last time that your body was not in contact with textiles? It would either be very briefly, from like the shower to the bed, you know, or the shower to when you put something on, or very briefly, or, you know, you go to a nudist colony or something, right? So this, which is the oldest technology, maybe the pointed stick or the rock is like older, but weaving is so ancient, it's, you know, beyond time, our historical time. And so it's so deeply human as an artifice. It's one of our fundamental artifices. And between the two of them, you've got everything human. You're kind of like, The language of the fabric formed concrete partakes by coincidence or by coincidence. It partakes of the two most fundamental things that we are, which is our body and then our clothing, our textiles. So the formal language itself already comes from this deep well, and it's like, and it's totally different from the machine language of machine modern. It's like utterly different from the language of the, you know, the single axis mill and the extrusions and all of that stuff. So I don't know what to do with it architecturally. Like, what does that mean for architecture? You could build like this. It's a simple way to build. It's very efficient in many, many ways. But these two ways, the pressurized and the non-pressurized, like what to do? Is there another architecture? What difference does it make? to change the formal language? Does it matter? But that, those are kind of open questions that that I don't know the answer to, but are certainly raised by them, in my mind at least. So that's a technical question, technical answer, but like, you know. There's another one here. We can circulate more than one. It's okay. You can be the gopher next time.
I was reading through your extensive bibliography from your new book, and I noticed that there are numerous sources from engineering people out there, and there was this one that stood out that I've read myself called The Spell of the Sensuous, if any one of you has read it, 1967. So my question is, when you are in that mode of discovery, because you're talking about at the beginning of your lecture of this things emerging through or finding things that are already there, which part governs? Because your work marries the two, the sensual aspect, the poetic sensual aspect of the material of the architecture, and then there's the structural analysis, knowing that you don't need that 30% of concrete to make your beam. How does your brain flip between the two or connect the two?
I mean, on the one hand, you could say there are two different lines of work. So one is sustainable construction, reduce the amount of cement consumed. That's a serious project. You know about cement, it's really, really bad, bad material for the, it's huge greenhouse gas content in its manufacture. So we'd like to use less of it. So that's a project. So there's the bullseye, and then you try to hit the bullseye, right? The other work is like drawing the bullseye first. That one is drawing the bullseye first and then trying to hit it with a rifle. The other work is you shoot a shotgun and you draw a bullseye around all the holes.
Good answer.
That happened. Like, this happened. Look at that. What could you do with that? Turn it upside down, and they're like, hey, look, that, you could do this with it. You could do that. Scale it up here, blah, blah, blah. So that's a finding process. And the other one is you have a project you have to solve. So that there are two different modes of work, strategies or methods, two different research methods, we say, right? This is where methodology really matters, actually. It really matters. The method itself already is you're going to arrive somewhere else by virtue of the method that you choose. But of course, I only know how to hit the bullseye of the structural reduction because I've studied, and I studied, had a great structural education, and I studied the fabric by playing with it, actually. So by playing with it, you learn what it can and can't do, what it wants to do, what it doesn't want to do. So I guess they're different lines of research. What does one govern? Govern is maybe an unfortunate word,
Thank you.
Okay.
The related question is, when you think about your work, is it more M.C. Escher or Hieronymus Bosch?
More who? Escher or Escher?
Hieronymus Bosch.
Hieronymus Bosch or Escher?
Yes.
Wow. Oh, which work? The drawing work? Or?
Well, you fixed on the Hieronymus Bosch image at the very end, but you showed us some M.C. Escher-like tessellations in some of your built works.
In the masonry stuff, you mean, for example?
Or the tile work, the Guastavino stuff.
Right. Oh, always think of Max Ernst, actually. You know, Max Ernst is like my daddy. Yeah, more Max Ernst than Hieronymus Bosch. I mean, Hieronymus Bosch, this is an interesting question to me at least, like there's a project in the choice of the figures and the, you know, little stories or moral tales that I can't read out of them, but they tell me, that art historians tell me, are in the thing, you know, they're like little lessons, moral lessons. And of course they're done in a way which is so crazy that, and we've lost we don't know the little folk tales that they refer to, so they're released into a surreal landscape for us. But they're quite, you know, they're quite willfully constructed, each of the, you know, the beak and the whatever it is, you know, the guy on the wheel and all that kind of crazy. So they're all willfully constructed. Max Ernst finds his stuff in the same method. He never said that, but I know. You look at the drawings, you can tell. I could tell. You know, him, Mata also, Roberto Mata, works by similar sort of hallucinatory method. As did, by the way, as did Leonardo da Vinci, who in his advice to a young painter advises that you stare at a water-stained wall in which you will see many marvelous things. Right. So I'm not giving you an answer that's like an art history answer or art answer. Maybe you're asking something different by way of those two references. I don't know if I really got it.
I just want to know how you think it through, and I think that answers my question.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Want to run that back there?
Hi. It's me here.
Oh, he's got the microphone. You might have to come wrestle the microphone from him. Okay, go ahead.
Hi. All right. Thank you very much for this very interesting and heterogeneous experience through the visual world and technical world. And it's interesting to see how the poetic and abstract aspect of your painting or of your collages of organic elements then find a solution in constructed drawings and built structures. I was looking to the way you were talking about this, reversing the code. Something is horizontal, becomes upside down, and there's another shape. And images came to my mind of sculptures that I personally found very interesting and strongly correlated to this. Is the Ludovico Albertoni Bernini and the Cristo Velato de San Martino. So the matter that is pressured from inside and the matter that is pressured from outside, and how those things can give in some way an idea of lightness through heavy materials, through rocks or through concrete. What I found that very, while I find that very interesting, I'm also intrigued from the fact of how this experimentation can become something that doesn't lose its performability, its transformability, because in some way, this lightness of the fabric, this way that the fabric blows with the wind and can change and variate, and Christo was exploring those things, gets in some way frozen in the final structure. So I find interesting your latest movies where you were showing the possibility for this structure to still to keep this dynamic effect, this quality of being transformable and readaptable, which is something that I think is the nature of that, and is the nature of your collage as well. So it's not a question, but just something to think about. And if you have a thought to the sculpturing also them and be inspired in some way from them?
Yeah, no, what you're saying is very close to my heart, and you don't have to put concrete on the fabric. So, you know, it can still blow in the wind if you just leave it as a textile. And I must say that the textiles actually are always more beautiful, centrally more beautiful, I put it that way, than the lithic version, than the rigidified concrete version. You know, they're translucent, as you say, you know, they move, and it doesn't just remind you of clothing. I mean, they really are a kind of clothing on the building. But there's something else also that happens when the action of the molding and forming is fixed and frozen. And what happens is a kind of stoppage of time. That's how there's such strange things. They're present, they have a kind of weird, surreal presence. Because you think they're soft, you touch them and they're very hard. So there's kind of a surreal objects in that sense. But there's also, you can read in them, anyone could read in them the struggle, especially not all of them really, but the pressurized one is in a special way, this kind of struggle of containment or the struggle of resistance. And that's like a photograph. It has the same power, like you can see a guy jumping over a puddle, and that's sort of nice to see someone jump over a puddle, but there's something magical happens when you freeze this moment. He's like eternally jumping over the puddle. He's never gonna stop jumping over the puddle. So the motion kind of goes on by virtue of stopping the motion. And I think there's something in the language of this architecture, or the potential of the language of this architecture, is precisely that the motion and the force would remain, look at me like the little smiling masonry things as opposed to there's something very powerful about that as well. And you lose the sensual precision of the textile itself, but you gain this other weird, you get another, like a bone, weird, I don't know if it's a psychological bonus or a poetic bonus that comes from fixing the thing, and also from changing the material. So it looks like you think it's fabric, but it's not fabric. So you get those two things. And then you can have both. You can have all of it. Like in that courtyard, the pink courtyard of the Hotel Edward Hopper, like I don't know whether that fabric is cloth or whether it's concrete. I really don't know. Sometimes I look at the drawing, I say, oh, it would be much better if it was cloth and move in the wind, you know. I say, well, what if it was like some were fixed and some were moving? Because you can leave the fabric on the cast too, right? You don't have to expose the concrete. You can leave the fabric on the cast. You're going to have like one curtain like this, you know. And the other one like that when the wind's not blowing, and that's just like one of them moves. I don't know. That's all available.
Hello, my name is Valerie, and I have a question. So I wrote down, since when did we become removed from the fabric in structure? As you showed us various different engineers using this in previous times, and what is holding us behind from doing it now? And was it steel that came into effect that removed us from using concrete, maybe more based here in New York City?
That's a really good question.
And also, sorry.
Okay, go ahead.
It would be nice to see a section of your columns, because I like knowing that there's nothing inside of them, but the structure is outside of them, but you totally remove that.
That part I don't understand. That question I don't understand.
So if you draw a section through your columns, let's say.
Like a fabric cast concrete column, yeah. solid concrete, just section through that.
Yeah, right? To know the layers of it.
The layers of it, so it's solid concrete, right?
Would it, if you drew a section through it, would it just be like full concrete that you see?
Ah, okay, yes. So when you, those kind of inflated molds, that's just filled with, like a water balloon, it's filled with concrete.
Okay.
It's filled with solid concrete. And the section, unless you really, really do something energetic to the mold, will always be a circle.
Oh, okay.
Unless it's cast horizontally, in which case it could be a teardrop or one of those other spline curves. Right. And then the other question of what, you know, okay, so there's all these things in history. It was used, and then it got lost, and then it got reinvented, and then it got lost, and then it got reinvented, and then it got lost, and now it's been reinvented again. was reinvented in the mid to late 1980s by three people simultaneously. That's also interesting to me. Myself, Rick Fearn, and Kenzo Uno. And we did not know about each other. So Rick Fearn's inventing the, he's the guy who makes the products, the foundation things and the column things, he was inventing it. Kenzo Uno was doing that for his own work and his architectural practice, and then I was doing it as an academic. And we're doing it for the first time using plastic fabrics. All the previous history was using burlap, not a really good material. If you cut burlap, it'll rip, like zzz, you know, it's catastrophic tearing. If you cut these polypropylene or polyethylene fabrics, they don't rip. They will not propagate a tear. They're brilliant. Nothing sticks to them. I'll answer your question in a second. Nothing sticks to them. Epoxy doesn't stick to them. So you don't need any form release agents. They just come right off. You can reuse them over and over and over again. When you're all done, you put them in the ground, which is what they're designed to do, you know. So it's the perfect material. It's a perfect formwork material. So there's that little bonus now that we actually have the right material to do fabric form concrete. Before, the poor guys were like struggling with hemp and hessian and burlap and all this stuff, right? Now, every other time that it's been used successfully, commercially successfully, the person who invented it had a construction company. They all had construction companies. FISAC not, but FISAC worked very closely with a precast factory and the successors to his, there's another firm right now in Spain that's using the same technology for low-cost housing construction and concrete, using the same factory. And then if you think about this, you know Heinz Eisler, or do you know Pierluigi Nervi, and also Eladio Dieste, all structural architectural inventions of the first order, brilliant shit, like brilliant. They all had, Eisler had one construction company he worked in partnership with, and everyone else owned their own construction companies. So, when I get inquiries from architects, they want to do a project. In the beginning, I was all like eager beaver, say, yeah, let's do it, you know, and it hit the wall when it came to the contractor giving a price. The contractor can't give a price. I told you that in that canopy job, the precaster, who I had worked with for 15 years by then, I would take my students to the same precast factory, and they were doing all these experiments right there. And he couldn't give a price on a shell. I said, well, I can give you the volume of concrete. He says, no, you don't understand, Mark. This is not a science, it's an art. And we can't give a price unless we've done it before. And that's why we had to do the flat plate slab. And we had to make the molds. We couldn't give it to them to make the molds. Even though the molds are really easy to make, how does the guy give a price on it, or how does a woman give a price on it, if there's no experience? So it hits the wall when it comes to the contractor and the giving of a price. And since we work on a spec and bid system fundamentally, that's where it is. Now, if I decided to start a construction company, a mold making company, and we could build lots of stuff. But I don't want to do that. That would like wreck my life. So I'm not going to do it. I keep waiting for one of my students to do it. Right? Some of them would do it. But then what happens? That person dies. You know, and then it stops. So something, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, the history is very sobering. It's very encouraging because you see, well, yeah, you know, you could make money off of this stuff. But it's also sobering. Yeah?
Hi. So you mentioned weaving textiles, and it's a different person.
I can see.
So you mentioned weaving textiles, and you also mentioned your no tailoring rule.
Right.
I was wondering if you had ever dealt with or worked with engineered fabrics, where you can have one area, you kind of program the fabric, so it has one area that's more tense and one that has more give. And so when you fill it with concrete, in gravity, it stretches out more in one location and less in the other. So I'm wondering if you've worked with that at all and if that violates your no-telling rule.
The only reason I make the rule is because I'm a builder. My background is in construction before I ever studied architecture or anything, right? And those guys were my first teachers. And I was so stunned by how simple everything was. You know, the layout procedure, you do these things, and the next three steps are all encoded in that one little pencil line. It's like, that's so brilliant. You know, the chalk line, oh, so brilliant. You draw, like, what a beauty. And that's the builder's culture. And so I wanted it to be available to anybody, anywhere, in the simplest possible way. So that's like a builder's constraint. If there was a simple way that of having some other complex thing, combo that was actually really simple, like for sure. So that's the only reason I make the rule. The rule is not for the sake of the rule. The aneurysm column, the one that had the spandex and the holes cut out of it, that's a kind of like engineered fabric, but it's using two different fabrics with two different deflection characteristics that make a form that you can't make otherwise, right? That's also kind of dead simple, just one thing inside the other. The engineered fabrics, and if you know North Sails, this fantastic, like most incredibly high-tech textile thing where they're making sails for fancy racing yachts and stuff, and like what's unbelievably sophisticated. In fact, the whole textile design industry is unbelievably complex and sophisticated. It's a very deep, deep technological field. Okay. I have never wanted to engineer a fabric specifically like that. I have no desire to do it. First of all, it would be expensive. You'd have to engineer the fabric. Then you have to do a production run. And how much are you going to make? Right. So there's that. And then once you make it, so let's say you made enough that the factory could produce it, are you going to use it enough times? And why wouldn't you just like do several layers of fabric here and one layer of fabric there, do some other thing, or get a different form. I have an aversion to complexification and nationalization. I don't like to do that. It bothers me. And there is an architecture of excess, which you can see in many, many places at the moment, that comes from a culture of excess, architecture of excess, culture of excess. And so there's a long-winded answer to say, no, it doesn't interest me. And I had two students who had a background already in fashion design, and one with the flat pattern English tradition, and the other one with the French draping finding tradition, and they both did tailored molds, and they spent so much time making the molds, and then try a cast, and it didn't work. So I got this long, involved mold making thing. You know, try it again. And the things that they made weren't that interesting. Weren't any more interesting to me aesthetically or structurally than the structurally. You could do some stuff that you can't do with the flat sheet. That's true. You could make a joint that you wouldn't otherwise do. But right, it just gets complicated.
Thank you.
We have time for maybe one more question. Oh my God, there's five questions. Go for it.
Kind of a dense question, but I'll try and put it into a few words. So I heard you say a few times, like, all right, let's scale it up. And then I was trying to think of it's playful nature. And then at some point you have to stop and you have to, you know, set in. But then I heard you say that the person you were talking to make these things said, no, we can't give you a price because it's not a science, it's an art. So I want to know kind of like when or if this playful nature that you've developed ever stops in your process to go from this scale model that has no rules to a full-fledged iteration that you want to take into production.
Well, the model has its own rules. The model, if we're really playing, the model will make its own rules, and we will learn them from the materials themselves, right? And the scaling up is not much to it. Like you have to know how to build stuff, The way to do it full scale is all in the book. Every construction method that I could remember and think of, it was like a mind dump. You know, you can do it this way, you can do this way, okay, that goes in the book, that goes in the book, that goes in the book. So it's like a whole little toolkit of ways of holding, pulling, you know, restraining, making an edge, all that stuff is in there. And it's all pretty straightforward, very straightforward, really. I mean, it's a lot less complicated than building, a good wooden box, for example. That takes some real skill. You have to practice that. So once you've got the skills, it's you know, a push pin becomes the screwed piece of plywood. And so if you know, when you're building the model, if you know what the full-scale version of that thing that you're doing at 1 to 10, if you know what the full-scale version is, you're already planning the construction, right? And you say, okay, I need like 10 pull points. You say, okay, I'm gonna need that many pull points. I gotta get some rope or whatever it is. And so the scaling up, it scales up beautifully. Tension's always linear, I suppose. I don't know, you have a field of tension, but tension scales linearly. So the tension of the skin in the model is really easy to scale up. The pressure will scale linearly, but the volume cubes and the surface area squares. So the tension on the skin is more than squaring. It's like squaring with, and then the weight is cubing. So there's all these scaling factors that make the models not be, you get different proportions between the model and the full scale, but the action is exactly the same. And these molds are all about action. It's the action which makes the form. So if you understand the action, the same action will happen at full scale, exactly the same action. And a little tiny woven thing and a big woven thing does exactly the same thing, but it'll scale differently. It'll be wrinkles in this one and not wrinkles in that one. This will be like, blah, blah, and this will be here, right? So the scaling is not a big deal. It takes a bit of nerve if you don't have confidence in the model. And like I say, I was nervous a few times until finally it's like the model never failed me. It just never failed me. Even on the spraying concrete on a hanging piece of fabric, like how could that possibly work? You know? So, I don't know, does this get at your, have I satisfied your?
I would say so.
Okay, all right. And the playing is nothing more than paying really close attention, like actually paying attention, especially to the mistakes. The whole history of technology is a series of like the bottle that dropped and the person who misunderstood something over the telephone. And you know, it's all mistakes, pretty much. Because you don't find anything new unless you make a mistake. Because if you did good, you're just doing what you know how to do, right? I mean, that's the rule. It's the rule of the game. And I think it was Bruno Latour who made a definition of Pasteur. He wrote a thing about Pasteur's laboratory, like the first scientific laboratory, Louis Pasteur. And he said, Latour defines a laboratory, if I remember correctly, as an enclosed space separated from the larger world, in which a large number of mistakes can be made in a short period of time. It's a very concise description of a laboratory. Not the one that comes to mind first. If I say laboratory, you already think of, oh, like everyone knows what they're doing and it's all very, you know, carefully controlled. But if you're looking for something new, that's if you're doing a study or a test or something, that's a different activity. It's quite a boring activity. All right, thank you.